Church, good to see you all here this morning, and we're so glad that you are here to worship with us this morning. We want to welcome everyone in listening on Passion Radio and on Facebook, YouTube, and Vimeo. We want to welcome you all into worship with us this morning. For this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Let's stand as we have our verse this morning, as we read from God's Word. From the book of Isaiah. Chapter 9, verses 2 through 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fueled for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. The word of the Lord, and we respond, thanks be to God. Let's begin and sing praises to him this morning. Hark the herald, the angels sing.
We'll see glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joy for all nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, with angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Christ the everlasting Lord, made in time, behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb, veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lifts his glory by, born than man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give him second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to
Amen. Would you pray with me this morning? Dear Heavenly Father, we sing your praises and we do celebrate as Christmas continues to get closer and closer. We celebrate the birth of your Son. For we know Easter does not come without Christmas. And Lord, we thank you for what that means, the example that you showed even in your birth, that you humbled yourself, the God of the universe, humbling himself to become a little baby, to be born in a manger amongst the animals and amongst shepherds, amongst those people that society seemed to have cast off. You came for all of those, and you came humbly to be born. There was no trumpet sounding. There was no big coach to welcome you. There was no parade. Only the angels in heaven singing for shepherds to let them know, and a star to guide the wise men. Lord, we look at your example, Lord, and ask that you would help us to live out that example of humbleness and meekness. Lord, we know that that's what Christmas is about. Lord, we pray that you would be with Pastor Jay this morning as he comes to share a message that you've laid on his heart. Lord, that our hearts and our minds and our ears would be open and ready to receive, and it would be a time of encouragement. It would be a time of renewing and also a time of challenge to go forth and to share the gospel and to share what we've learned this morning. Lord, I praise you and thank you and ask for your hand upon this service as we continue. In Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, I have something unique for you this morning. One of my favorite songs, Our God. I just love the words to that song because, and if our God is for us, it says, then who could ever stop us? But this is a Christmas version that was arranged by Lincoln Brewster, and I wanted to share it with you this morning. And so sing this out. Let's continue our praise to the Lord. Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. And into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. For our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. And if our God is for us,
then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. And our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. Our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
Noel, 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 born is
What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping? Shepherds, God, and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. While lies he such meat estate, where ox and ass are feeding, good Christians fear for sinners here. The silent word is pleading. Nails, spears shall pierce him through. The cross be home for me and you. Hail, hail the Word made flesh, the babe, the Son of Mary.
Amen. You may be seated this morning.
I rolled out this morning, the kids said the morning news show on. Brian Gumbel was talking about the fighting in Lebanon. Some senator was squawking about the bad economy. It's gonna get worse, you see. We need a change of policy. There's a local paper in a rubber band. One more sad story's one more than I could stand. Just once, how I'd like to see the headline say, not much to print today, can't find nothing bad to say, because nobody robbed a liquor store on the lower part of town. Nobody OD'd, nobody burned a single building down. Nobody fired a shot in anger, nobody had to die in vain. We sure could use a little good news today. I'll come home this evening, I bet that the news will be the same. Somebody takes a hostage, somebody steals a plane. How I want to hear the anchorman talk about a county fair and how we cleaned up the air, how everybody learned to care. Whoa, tell me, nobody was assassinated in the whole third world today. In the streets of Ireland, all the children had to do was play. And everybody loves everybody in the good old USA. We sure could use a little.
we sure could use a little good news today.
Luke's Gospel, the second chapter in verse 10. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about the child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. The shepherds returned, glorifying, praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Over 2,000 years ago, good news was delivered to shepherds. And they in turn went to see what had been told to them, and they discovered the Christ child. Today I'd ask that we would pray that God would allow us to understand clearly the message of good news that the angels brought the very first Christmas. Father, we've assembled here this Sunday before Christmas, and some of us have been in a tizzy. Some of us have missed and lost sleep. Some of us have been wondering what the next chapter of our life unfolds. Christmas is upon us. And I ask that this year that there'll be a clearer understanding, a deep appreciation, an acceptance of the good news in our lives. For it is in the precious name of Jesus I ask these things. Amen. Yes, it is Christmas. It is December 2020, and what will we remember about this day? On this Lord's Day morning, right before Christmas, many of us are experiencing joy and peace and happiness that comes during this festive season. We've enjoyed foods that we normally don't eat. We may have eaten too much, and maybe we're trying to already drop back down what we are trying to accomplish. But the other hand, many others are experiencing the agony of what is known as the Christmas blues. Why is it that some people feel this way at Christmas time? What is the contributing factors that lead to this? Some of this is because we have a continuous news feed in our lives. Many of us are aware of different publications such as the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the USA Today are the three largest newspapers in America, even though subscriptions are down and people reading have not been what it once was. Someone once said, if you read the newspapers, you're misinformed, and if you don't read the newspapers, you're uninformed. And so we really need to be a person who is aware, and also we have not only the newspapers, but we have continuous news feeds on different types of media sources, whether it be Fox News or whether it be CNN or CNBC, ABC. Because some people with free reading and watching and listening to news feeds will experience depression at Christmas time because they have an exaggerated expectation of themselves and others. They hope that Christmas will solve many of the problems that they have at the present time, but the amazing thing is it often doesn't. And so there are those who go into despondency. At Christmas time, we realize that we have a great need for the dependence of others in our lives. And when that doesn't happen, it becomes quite depressing. Children can all ask for some amazing things at Christmas. I being one of them. I can remember telling my dad I would like to have a car with a bow on top of it, meaning that I wanted a new car in the driveway when I got up on Christmas morning with a big red bow. And my dad did deliver. He got me one of those little models wrapped in a white piece of paper and red bow on top. In the United States, Christmas is a family-oriented experience. And oftentimes you ask, what is Christmas? And the first thing that they will say, Christmas is family. But never really realizing the reason why we celebrate Christmas is because God has sent a great gift to all mankind. There are times when we think back in our memories of Christmas, they come to the forefront. Some of these are blight rather than blessed. Some hurt more than help. It's highly possible that each of us will come into contact with someone during this week or during the next few days experiencing depression. Depression can be detected in one who experiences the seriousness of things like loss of sleep or appetite. And if you're alert to it, you will find people all around you who may be depressed during this Christmas season. It has been suggested by Christian leaders since the beginning of Christmas as we know it and experience it that we can give some type of psychological first aid to the depressed people, and we can engage them with us in meaningful activity, such as volunteering to help someone else. Maybe there are times that helps us to realize that we can alter our goals. I want to have the house decorated 2.5 hours after the Thanksgiving meal. I want to have everything ready for Christmas the Friday after Thanksgiving. And we can't go into the weekend, Saturday and Sunday. And so all of a sudden we have unrealized expectations on our life. Maybe you walk into your home with family members and we don't have those Christmas goodies that we've been looking for this year. We need to break down our task into little pieces so they can get a firm grip on what we expect of ourselves as well as others. In these ways we can help ourselves as well as others who have that depressed feeling and be more hopeful and optimistic. Another sad issue about Christmas time is that alcohol consumption increases during the holiday season. Those who use alcohol as a means of coping with stress and depression find that it does relieve the tension temporarily. But ultimately, it worsens the depression. So, the message of Christmas, which is supposed to produce great joy, have anything to say to people who are struggling during the Christmas season? Christmas, which we understand and know, and Christianity, which begins with the promise of good news. Will that bring great joy to those who may not understand the message of Christmas, or maybe they're looking for something else to fill the void in their life? Yes, there is a promise of good news, but it's more than a tragedy that engages hope with the pressures of life. The Christ that came that first Christmas, God provided the ability to cope in a manner of life which brings us to reflect his glory. The gospel, which is not good advice, but good news, can produce great joy in everyday living. There is good news about God in the gospel. It's going to be found in the sacred book that we often call as a Bible. In a generation and in a country and in a language, we have more Bibles written than any generation in the history of Christianity. There's no reason why we can't understand the message. There's no reason why we cannot be given an opportunity to know it. Many of us have been given, some of us have purchased a Bible, and it begins to unfold the message of Christmas, that God is behind and above because he is a living God. There are many people who attack the Bible because it does not seek to tell us when and how the universe came into being, because really none of us, including scientists, really don't have all the answers to all the mysteries. But what does the Bible major on is this concern of who and why the earth was created. The writer of the book of Hebrews, by faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what was seen was not made out of what was visible. You will find that in Psalm 147:4, an interesting statement. He determines the number of the stars and calls them by name. This particular passage became very meaningful for me in Christmas many years ago. A lady by the name of Patty was a woman that had many tragedies in her life. Her husband, father of a child, was tragically killed in an Air Force accident. She returned home, and because of her choices in life, her life was really broken and coming to the point of being destroyed. We visited, shared the message of hope, of salvation. She prayed to receive the gift of eternal life. She was baptized. And during Christmas, she was fascinated with the star that shone over Bethlehem. Tomorrow night, I think if you will be right at sunset looking into the southwest, you'll see an amazing arrangement of the planets and a very bright star. Though many scholars don't necessarily believe that this took place, because it was a miracle that took place over Bethlehem when Jesus was born. But it'd be an amazing phenomenon that'll take place that we won't get to see another time for another 800 years. I don't think I'll be around to watch it. When she became a follower of Christ at Christmas, she cross-stitched a small little framed cloth, this verse. She came to the realization that there was a God who loved her, who created the universe, created her in his image, and allowed her to be forgiven. Puts the stars in space, casts them into the heavens, and gives them each a name. The message of Christmas speaks to us of a living God that is above, behind the world of which you and I live in today. He is a God who comes into the world and wants to dissipate our fears and encourages us to live a life of faith. The message of Christmas proclaims the good news about a living God who loves each one of us. And in Jesus Christ, the living God declares that he cares and wants to help us. In Jesus Christ, the world needs to hear the great, precious gifts that God gives to human beings. And you and I can receive six great gifts at Christmas this year. And I'd like to share those gifts with you. It simply begins with that of love, joy, peace, hope, purpose, and forgiveness. Those are the great gifts of Christmas. And literally, they are for all of us. Love. At Christmas, God demonstrates his love for us by sending his son to be born a human baby, to live among us, and ultimately die on a cross. As we receive God's love, we are transformed by it. We're called to turn to God because of his love. As we receive God's love, this transformation allows us to become representatives of his, the Father God, the creator and maker of all things, into this broken world in which we live. Another gift he gives us is joy. The angels announced to the shepherds the coming of Jesus. It was great joy, a joyful event after they became overcoming their fear. God had come to live among us. You know, you and I live in a world sometimes that life can be quite difficult. Even on a daily basis, the responsibilities that we have, the things that we do, the things that happen to us while things we go about our daily routines. God had come to live among us. And in this difficult time that you and I have experienced in 2020, we can experience great joy no matter what we may face. God's presence in our lives is always a reason for joy because we can experience it like nothing else matters. There is peace. Prophet Isaiah spoke of the Messiah as the Prince of Wholesomeness, the Prince of Peace. And so often reflect on that peace and the wholeness and the gift of Christmas. Another gift that is given at Christmas is hope. The world is filled with what I call conflict and anxiety and loneliness and suffering. And may I add, even today, fear? We have been living in fear since the middle of March. We're fearful to live and we're fearful to die. Jesus offers us this personal wholeness and peace with God and his people. And in his first coming, of which we know that is the celebration of Christmas, we realize that he brings this wholeness and this peace to us. This eternal wholeness will give us hope in the middle of life, who we are living oftentimes without it. Even the hope of eternal life, when this earth as we know it comes to an end. Then there's this thing called purpose. By sending his son at Christmas time to reconcile us to himself, God demonstrates his desire to reach out to each of us and call us into three things. And may I mention this, because this is a process, a cycle that every person comes to faith in Christ will go through. One, you have a friendship with God. Then there is the lordship of Christ, and then they become representatives of his on this earth. So let's explain that just a little bit. We come into a friendship with God. We begin to realize, hey, there must be something beyond this world as I know it. In my universe, there must be a God somewhere. And we begin to build a friendship with God. Some people search for it in other religions, but oftentimes people begin to read the Bible for the first time. Some begin to go to church. Some begin to sing the songs. Some begin to listen to Christian radio. Some will go to bookstores and try to find spiritual material to help them in the journey of life. They are just a friend entering into a friendship with God. In this process, there are those who come to faith in Christ. They begin to identify the fact that Jesus is the Son of God who was born of a virgin and came into this world on that first Christmas, and he becomes real, and we come under the lordship of Christ. We begin to develop and grow as individuals. We call that disciples. That discipleship process is ongoing. But the tragedy, many Christians stop there. They stop. They do their Holy Bible study. They reflect on it. They pray. They even look at other Christians. Why come they're not as good as me or good as us? They don't look like us. They don't talk like us. They don't sing like us. They don't study the same passages in the Bible we do. All of a sudden, we become, I call them inspectors. What's the process? We become a friend of God. We become under the lordship of Christ, and then we become his representatives in the world in his redeeming work. Look at the shepherds. They were told that Jesus had come into the world. They went to see, and when they went to see, they found him, and then they started telling everybody, and everybody was amazed. That is the process of a normal Christian. We begin to experience what God is like. We accept him into our life under his lordship. We become part of his redeeming work in the world. And that's why we work so diligently to build the Christian message into the lives of individuals. Through his death on the cross, Jesus would pay for our guilt before God and pave a way to our reconciliation with him. And those who have been forgiven, we are called not only to experience that forgiven ourselves, but to give that forgiveness to all those who have wronged us in our lifetime. Do you realize that God's message is for all people? The good news is for all people. You will notice that there seems to be in every part of the world, masses of people. Aren't we glad that we live in the Southwest, where there's a little space where we can see sunrises and sunsets? We're not looking through the shadows of big buildings all the time. We are blessed. Some people in the world live in different parts of the world, and there are massive amounts of humanity. We've been called as individuals to take the gospel message of good news to the masses of the world. That's why at Christmas time we celebrate what is known as the Light of Moon Christmas offering, and in gathering our Christmas offering to send missionaries literally around the world. We train missionaries. Many of them are required to have some type of biblical knowledge, maybe a degree in biblical studies or Christian education or missionology. And those degrees help them understand the call of God in their life to go forth into the world as ambassadors, as apostles, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ to a different language group, a different culture group, a different geographical region of the world where the food is different, and the clothes is different, and the climate's different. And we go and we proclaim the gospel message. See, the good news of Christmas is universal in its application. It meets the deepest needs of all people, of all colors, of all cultures, of all countries. And we go forth with a gospel message. God and Jesus comes with good news regarding the forgiveness of sin. Forgiveness does not appear in the glossary of psychiatry. Did you realize that? There's a psychiatry dictionary, and the word forgiveness does not take place there. The psychiatrist does not have a basis for offering the gift of forgiveness to those who are experiencing depression because they have broken God's law or have violated their own conscience. Jesus Christ came that he might bear the penalty of our sin and to offer us the priceless gift of forgiveness. You realize that Jesus Christ brings good news regarding life around the world and in every age, people have stood in terror of death because of sin. In John, the first chapter and verse 4, in him was life, and that life was the light of men. The assurance of a life that endures beyond certain people called death can do much to dispel the gloom that threatens the souls of human beings. I have watched in the last 7 months people who are fearful. Now, we need to have a respect for people, and we need to have a care for people, and we need to pray for people. People need to seek medical attention. Nobody wants the dreaded COVID virus. But that's not the root cause of their fear. The root cause of the fear is they're scared to die. Once we overcome the fear of death and the hope that we have in Christ, we understand what we're faced with as individuals, and we accept the good news of hope that we have in Christ. Jesus Christ spoke good news about belonging to God and the family of God. The church is spoken to oftentimes as a family, a household of faith, a warm Bible study group, Sunday school class, a discipleship group that meets can provide tremendous amount of support for anyone who's experiencing stress, struggles, separation, much pain, hurt in their life. A genuine Christian friend can be a tremendous help in a time of crisis. This Christmas, let us extend hands of Christian love and fellowship to those who are experiencing loneliness and discouragement during Christmas, because we are bearers of good news. Christ brings good news regarding help. Every one of us will stand in need of help of God and others as time goes by in the journey of life. Paul understood it clearly in Philippians when he said, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. The psalmist bore the same testimony when he said, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Our God is a refuge and strength and an ever sense of help in time of trouble. There are times when people are going to need God in their life, and they will need to know where to turn, who to call, who to ask, where to seek help. And some people turn to all kinds of ways to try to end the struggle and the issues that they face. But you and I become, may I use the term, agents? May we be aware of what's taking place in the lives of individuals? See, John, the 14th chapter, beginning verse 1, says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. And if it were not so, I would have told you, I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. Many of us are looking for that kind of place, a place of refuge, a place of hope, even a house. Many homeowners consider their home to be their best investment. But do you realize there are many who have not experienced the joy of home ownership, something they can call their own? But through the grace of God and the provisions that Jesus Christ offers, all believers can look forward to having a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. God has provided for us that place where we can experience acceptance, place of home, place of rest, even from our labors. That is a great gift. Now let's stop and think about that gift of forgiveness and hope that God has in life. Let's think back on all the Christmases that we have experienced. What are some of the greatest gifts that you have received. Endless amount of shirts and pieces of clothing that I've received at Christmas, because that's really something I really like to receive. What's happened to all of those Christmas shirts that I've owned, you've owned? Or Christmas shoes? Or Christmas purse? At some point in time, they wear out. They're gone. Whatever you received at Christmas time as gifts may not be as timeless as we think that they might have been. But when I look back and look at some of the things that I've received, even at Christmas, some of those are labors of love, an extension of someone's life. This year, we received an African, a Baptist woman, another city, sent us an African, large enough to cover a bed. And then you think about the number of hours and the little stitches it took to make that. Our grandparent that made a quilt for you and gave it to you at Christmas time. Our photographs that you have taken of Christmas years past and look at those things and remember those people. Those are the real priceless gifts at Christmas. And we look at Jesus Christ and things that he desires for us at Christmas time. I think, honestly, there are four things that we need to do this year at Christmas. Each one of us, in our heart and in our mind, need to understand what Christmas really is for us. Let us individually respond to the good news that the angels sang about on that very first Christmas. We respond to this as individuals. It's not my mother's faith. It's not my father's faith. It's not the faith that grandma had or my grandfather had. It is my personal invitation, individually responding to the grace of God that is offered to us as a free gift at Christmas. The second thing we must do at Christmas is let us trust in Jesus Christ as the promised Messiah. The prophets of old proclaim, as we read this morning from the book of Isaiah, that God was promising to send a Messiah, and he came into this world. The angels announced it. The shepherds understood it, and they went to find him, and they found him. Maybe it is this Christmas you find Jesus Christ, really, for the first time in your life. You move from being a friend of God to under his lordship in Christ, and then when you accept that, he puts us on a mission in our lifetime. And our mission field is our families and our neighbors and our work associates and the people that we run into just haphazardly in the course of life. We are engaged in this because we have trusted Christ as the promised Messiah who came to meet the deepest needs of our life. The third thing we need to do is trust in his death for the forgiveness of sin and in his resurrection and living presence as a gift of eternal life. See, Jesus is alive. He was born. He lived a life without sin. He died on a cross. He was placed in a tomb. The stone was rolled away. He resurrected from the dead. He ascended into heaven. His spirit lives among us. And he speaks to each individual who will open their spiritual ears and hear his voice. That'd be the greatest gift that you could ever receive in your lifetime. And then let us face life with the resources he promises. There has to be a confidence. There has to be an assurance. There has to be that peace in our life that only God can give, because he does give those six great gifts. He gives us the love, the joy, the peace, the hope, the purpose, and forgiveness. That is what has been given to us when we accept Christ. And when we stop to think about it, that's what really we want for Christmas, out of all the things we have. Now, you may be in this room today, and you maybe really begin to identify where you are as an individual. I've been a friend of God most of my life. I believe there's a God. I trust there's a God. I have read the stories about God. But you've never really given your life to God and allow him to become the Lord of your life. Too often, we have no difference in our lives than that of the people who do not know Christ. There's a lot of moral people who do not know Christ. But we live like we don't know God. We don't live by his standards. We need to come under his lordship. Maybe that's where you need to be today. Maybe you have accepted him in your life. You moved from friendship to lordship, but you've not been engaged in any kind of Christian ministry. When it comes to proclaiming individually to another individual who Jesus is and what he's done for you in Christ. Lord Jesus, there may be those that just simply need to say, God, I want you to come into my life and be the Lord of my life and forgive me of my sin. Be my Savior, be my Lord. For those who are believers, they may need to just engage in the Christian ministry. Father, we invite them to become really your representatives on this earth. And bless the people who are assembled here. Bless the people listening by radio. Bless the people who are watching through social media, and help them to understand the great gift that you give us at Christmas. May God richly bless each one. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Nathan gives us this time of service in the area of invitation and inviting people to come to faith in Christ. We make that decision public. We let us know.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life, and I know that it is finished.